boys hate girls. I get asked lots of questions about a lot of different things, and I've made several videos on smoking tips and things like that, but I really didn't explain the science behind it. And so I did a little bit of research, which I already knew all of this, but I didn't really know how to try to explain it to you fine people. Some of it may be a little bit above your heads. Some of it is like for the nerds or for the geeks who really want to know why slow cooking, smoking meats are more tender, and how does this process evolve and happen? Well, the first thing we need to do is let me read to you a little bit. No, it's not a bedtime story. I had to take notes because it's a lot. Okay, the challenge of cooking meat. We all like our meat tender and juicy at the same time. We therefore want our meat to be cooked tender, where the tough collagen is converted to gelatin, but with a minimum loss of moisture. The reality is that these methods are contradictory, and hence the challenge or dilemma to cooking meats. To minimize moisture loss, requires temperatures less than 130 Fahrenheit. However, turning collagen into gelatin requires temperatures above 160 for extended periods of time. As moisture evaporates, the meat begins to shrink. A slab can lose 20% or more of its weight due to shrinkage. Even meat that has been cooked in liquid will dry out, not as quickly. So we face with a dilemma. To liquefy the collagen, we need to cook the meat to 180 and hold it there for long periods. But by then, it's well past well done, and the muscle fibers can be dried out. As a result, we need to add moisture or use a fattier cut. What they're talking about here is a cut that is, let's say, pot roast style or oven roast style, roasting meat in the oven. If you're using a rump, it doesn't have a lot of internal fat where brisket does. If you're doing a loin, it doesn't have a pork loin. It doesn't have a lot of internal fat. So there's things you can do to enhance that. pH comes into a factor. So injecting these with an acid-based solution can help. And there's some other things. I'm going to show y'all a link to this website in the description box, where I got all this information from. It's very informative, and I've got a couple models down here to show you fine people, and they got pictures you can look at there too. It's called The Science of Cooking, and this is one of many articles on the site. Cut. Alright, so let's see here. A meat muscle. A muscle. Meat is muscle tissue, okay? Like the muscle in your arm or in your mouth. I bet Larry got a big mouth, a big muscle in his mouth. A muscle is completely enclosed by a thick sheath of connected tissue. The epromyosin. Yeah, that's it. And is divided into bundles or fibers of collected tissue network called a premyosin. The individual muscle fibers are bounded by a plasma membrane surrounded by connective tissue, embromyosin, which consists of a basement membrane surrounded by a rectal layer, which is the meshwork of fine collagen fibers embedded in a matrix, embedded in the matrix. So let me show and tell down here. I've got some bundles of just wire ties. These are like the little fibers, and in between the fibers are where the collagen is. Okay, and the fat, think of it like that, okay? So inside of a meat, inside of a muscle, you've got many of these little tubes of meat cells. Okay, and they're wrapped in what's known as the, what did I say? The pre-myosin. Okay, each one of these are. There's a bunch of them in there, a whole lot more than what I got right here. Okay, and they're in there. And this is the outer layer, which is the endomyosin. Okay, so they're all up in there and they're all wrapped in another layer. And then inside of these layers is where your fat and everything is. And naturally, you'd have a bundle. Oh, it'd be bigger than this for a, you know, here's a bunch of them. They would all each be wrapped with say like a straw. Okay, there's another one. And then the whole outside would be wrapped with the endomyosin like that. And then these are all joined to the bone by a tendon. Yeah, they're attached to the bone by a tendon. So if you're overcooking, let's say ribs, you make the tendon turn loose from the bone and you end up eating that, and it's okay. It's meat. I mean, it ain't gonna kill you. Just don't ingest the bone or snort it or something stupid like that. So, oh yeah, in between these bundles, in between these cell bundles are veins going through also that's holding blood. And as these things cook, the heat starts squeezing the liquid out of them. The fat stays in there until it melts, or the collagen. It's got to melt out. It's not going to be squeezed out because it's solid. Whereas the liquid, the water, is going to squeeze out. And any blood that's still in the veins that's in there, and they're not shown. So, we got that. Here's a couple of other things about it. So, falling apart tenderness, collagen turns to gelatin at 160 and above. The meat gets drier, but at 160 Fahrenheit, I'm talking about, the connective tissue containing the collagen begins to dissolve into gelatin. With time, the muscle fibers that have been tightly held together begin to easily spread apart. Although the fibers are still stiff, they're still stiff, the dry meat appears more tender because the gelatin provides a lube. The collagen, the gelatins, the collagen is melted into a gelatin. There was one other note in here. Yeah, here it is. Note at 140 Fahrenheit, changes are caused by the denaturing of the collagen in the cells. Meat served at this temperature, medium rare, is changing from juicy to dry. When it hits 160 Fahrenheit, connective tissue collagen begins to dissolve into gelatin. However, this is a very lengthy process, the plateau. That's why it hits that plateau. That's where your collagen is melting into gelatin, and it takes it a while. The fibers are still stiff, but the meat is more tender. Kind of like getting a lube job. It also mentions on this site about cooking it fat side up. It's the way to do it because the melting out fat cap, which is just collagen only, basically, or fat, is basting your meat as it's dripping down over it. It's not gonna go into it because these cells are getting squeezed, okay? And as the collagen or the fat that's within the cells is released, that's what's gonna moisturize the inside of your meat. But to keep the outside of it moist, you can either spritz it with water and cook it fat side down, that's the non-union way, or turn it fat side up and let it baste itself with the fat that's melting and going around the outside of your meat. Brisket and butts have tons of internal fat. Same way with pork ribs. They've got a lot of fat. So leaner cuts of meat, definitely don't cook them like that. Unless you're doing them in a liquid, like in a pot roast, or you wrap it in foil and you do in an oven, like in a roast beef in an oven, where it's covered in a pot, so it's basically steaming itself and it's cooking in its own juices as well. So it's in a steamed type environment. That's not necessary with brisket or butts because of all the fat that they contain. In Texas, there's even they started out open pit style. It wasn't a smoker. They would build a fire and sear the meat and just keep moving it around off the fire and do this for hours and hours and hours. It's a time consuming process. So we just want to let y'all know that, and we'll have a. I hope you're recording. Good, you is. I didn't want to have to repeat all that again. I should have checked. Boy, I'd have been some pissed off if you wasn't recording, you dumbass camera. Let me think. I think I wanted to add something else. Yeah. Now, if you overcook your meat, not only has all the liquid been released from the cells, but you also start to push out all your collagen. It starts oozing out as well. And you're gonna end up with a dry piece. So for brisket, about 195, you know, somewhere in there. For butt, about 200, somewhere in there. General rule. Slicing. Look down here, more show and tell. Never slice your meat. See, here's all your fibers. Never slice it this way. You want to cut it this way, across the grain of your fiber, or your cell structures, okay? This way, not this way. What else I had? You can add flavor internally to dense cuts like pork loin, for instance. We use that one, or chicken breast, by injecting it with an injection needle. And I probably got one, I don't see it, I ain't gonna bother. But all you're doing, you're not injecting it into the cells, you're sticking that needle in there, or in here, and just simply making a pocket. Like, it pushes the cells apart like that, so now you got a little pocket of juice, flavored juice. So it actually puts a flavoring in the cells, in between the cells, because, no, you ain't gonna, when you push that needle in, you just divide the cells like that. They gonna move. You ain't gonna puncture them. Think of a hunk of meat is an Olympic-sized swimming pool full of water balloons. And if you poke a stick down in there, a dull stick, which is, this is microscopic, where, okay, it's just like this. The balloon is just gonna move out of the way. If you throw a needle in there, but it had to be microscopic, you may puncture a few cells on the way in, but you'll never notice them being missing. Brining is a good way to help a piece of meat out. So it's tenderizing, you know, either with a jacquard, you know, one of them things with all them pranks on it that you, yeah, here's one here. You hammer down on the meat and it pokes a bunch of holes in it. That's for tougher cuts. Flank steak really likes that. You can also use your meat hammer. That's what it's for. Tenderizing tough cuts. You wouldn't want to do that with a brisket or a butt. Just don't do it. Don't go there. You can see when in a chicken breast, a cooked chicken breast, you know how when you peel it, you see all these little fibers, all these little strings? That's your cells. And hopefully you ain't cook them till all the liquid done come out from the insides of each little cell, because they're hollow inside and that's where the liquid's at. This has got a piece of wire inside, but if it didn't, it would be a cell. Think of it like that. And they got pictures on that site. We'll show you all that. I think that's all we got. And we'll have a couple show and tell pictures of barbecue just for you to drool over. Try not to bite your monitor or lick it or drool in your keyboard. I ain't responsible for no dentist bills, wet keyboards, or broken monitors, teeth, etc. Drink a pop. Tell your friends about JB. Thank everybody for watching. Hope y'all learned something. Till next time. See y'all later. Oh, whoa. One more thing. Ground meat. What is ground meat? They take these cells and just grind them to pieces. Just like, just cut. Cut the shit out of them. That's your ground meat. So now, I'm going to run around the house with some scissors, swinging them. Yeah, so if you're new to JB's channel, I do all kind of stuff, not just barbecue. Do desserts, all kind of Cajun things. I'm just going to show barbecue in this because, and this is pastrami that you're looking at right now. this is pork shoulder. So I'm gonna show mostly barbecue in this. And I noticed I didn't have a lot of pulled pork. Okay, yeah, that looks like a London brawl. There it is, all whack up. Notice I didn't have a whole lot of chicken shown. Looks some brisket and tater salad that I made. And more ribs. I love ribs. Man, I make ribs more than anything. So I need to get some more, that's beef ribs too, by the way. More of them. Nah, that's pork. Yeah, that's beef. They out of order. Who cares? That's a pork loin that's been injected. Or it was injected. Yeah, some more briskets and so I need to do some more chicken and show you fine people. I got some pictures at the end. Yeah, you can see all them little cells in there. That's what we're talking about. Beef ribs. Man, I love me some. That look like a steak. Like a ribeye. Yeah. Well, that's poke rib. Poke rib. Chicken. There's chicken. And it's for Tango Joe. Yep. Still works, Joe. Boy, pay attention when I'm talking to you, damn it. shrimp salad. Yep. Yum.